guidelines to be laid in Parliament at the earliest opportunity.
Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. I beg to move that this House agree with the Senate in the amendments to Clause 5 of the Public Procurement and Disposal of Public Property Amendment Bill 2020. Now, there was quite a lot of discussion in the other place with respect to this particular clause. And in fact, this is the clause that attracted so much attention in the media and attracted a campaign in opposition. However, this amendment, the amendment to 5C, to exempt reports on procurement related to national security, this amendment revealed, I dare say for the first time to many people, a lot of the mischief and propaganda that was out there in the public domain. And let me explain exactly how this is to operate. Clause 7 of the Parent Act, the Public Procurement and Disposal of Public Property Amendment Bill, has four subsections. And subsection 3 and 4 indicate that the procuring entity, whichever that procuring entity is or whatever it is, whether it is a ministry, a department, a state enterprise, or a statutory authority, the procuring entity is required to provide to the Office of Procurement Regulation a report on all procurement that flow from the clauses preceding, which are the clauses dealing with exemptions with respect to government-to-government agreements and financing arrangements with international bodies and agreements with international bodies for technical assistance and so on. And what subsection 3 of section 7, which is what we are amending here, we're amending subsection 3. What subsection 3 of section 7 requires, it requires the procuring entity to send a compliance report to the Office of Procurement Regulation. And that compliance report must confirm whether the procurement of whatever it is, whether it is a government-to-government agreement for fast ferries or a government-to-government agreement for a hospital such as the Coover Hospital, or an agreement for the naval vessel that the member for Siparia saw when the honorable member went to China and procured one with God knows what procurement process, whether it is that or another government-to-government arrangement, the section 7, subsection 3, which we're amending, requires the entity who procures the goods or services to report to the procurement regulator on things like value for money, evaluation criteria, qualifications of bidders, the entire process, the integrity of the procurement process. And the regulator is then required to deliver to the speaker, your good self, Madam Speaker, within 21 days, that compliance report on the procurement, which the speaker is then required to lay in the parliament at the earliest opportunity. We have decided to exempt matters of procurement relating to national security for obvious reasons. If you want to procure specialized equipment for reasons of national security, you would not want to broadcast that to the world. So we have decided to exempt that compliance report with respect to matters of national security from the requirement to be transmitted to the regulator for him to transmit to the speaker to be laid in parliament. But the whole point is that the only exemption from a compliance report will be this one, matters of national security. every other matter of procurement by way of government-to-government agreement or by way of agreement for cooperation with another public body in another territory will be sent to the Parliament with a comprehensive report on it for public scrutiny. And I wanted to make that point because a lot of mischief outside there that what the government was doing was hiding from the public the facts and the nature of government-to-government procurement. That is an absolute untruth. Because of Section 7.3, the compliance report must go to the regulator, must go to the speaker, who must lay it in Parliament for the world to see. So with the only exemption from that kind of compliance reporting will be national security, and that's the purpose of this amendment. With respect to the services that we seek to exempt, we made some modifications to tighten up the definition of exactly what we are seeking to do. So rather than simply saying financial services, which is what was there in the original amendment bill, we have deleted the words financial services and replaced them with debt financing services for the national budget. So we make it crystal clear that the exempt service is debt financing service for financing the budget deficit and so on. With respect to medical, again, to tighten it up to deal with the matters that we had discussed, we have added after the word medical in terms of medical services, emergency or other scheduled medical services, and that would treat with the examples we had given with respect to the need to have very quick and swift procurement in times of a medical emergency or somebody needs to have a scheduled surgery and so on. And also to give the Parliament the power to approve or disapprove of any new services that might not be on the list, because the list is now debt financing services, emergency medical services, and a few others, in order to give the Parliament the power to approve or not approve any new services that the minister might want to add by order. We changed the word negative to affirmative, so therefore these things must be debated and must be approved by both houses of Parliament. And just in passing, Madam Speaker, I might say that we found it necessary to do these amendments because this is what is done in other countries in the Caribbean. It's nothing new. With respect to Big B now, we were requested by members in the other place to provide further transparency. So we have agreed to this amendment here, and we are proposing it for the consideration of this Honorable House, that the procurement of debt financing services and medical emergency services and so on would not be on a carte blanche basis, would not be on an open-ended basis. And the Minister of Finance is now required to submit to the Office of Procurement Regulation annual guidelines which would circumscribe and outline the circumstances under which these exempted services may be procured. So it's not an open system. The Minister of Finance will indicate the guidelines and define in more detail what exactly would be medical emergency services and debt financing services and so on. And that when those are forwarded to the Office of the Procurement Regulator on an annual basis every year, we would send the guidelines. The office would then, the regulator, would forward the guidelines to the speaker, who would cause the guidelines to be laid in Parliament at the earliest opportunity. So that, Madam Speaker, we believe that these amendments will significantly improve the amendment bill that was before this House, went to the other place and has come back, and that we believe also that the addition of the large B will add further transparency to the conduct of the government and various government agencies in procurement. And I want to repeat that the large A, in that large A, the report being referred to is a compliance report which must be sent to the procurement regulator and also laid in the Parliament at the earliest opportunity for everyone to see, discuss, debate, critique, as the case may be, procurement as it relates to government-to-government arrangements. I beg to move, Madam Speaker.
Honourable members, the question is that this House agree with the Senate in the amendments to Clause 5 of the Public Procurement and Disposal of Public Property Amendment Bill 2020. Member for Oropouche.